Come join me on my second channel, Jaguar Gator 8, where we'll talk all things college football. New video drops every Monday at 6 p.m. Eastern. Click the card in the upper right corner to watch the latest video. And now, on with our feature presentation. After the 1980 season, the Houston Oilers, despite making the playoffs in three consecutive seasons, having a winning record in each of the past four seasons, and making it to the AFC Championship in two of the past three seasons, decided to fire head coach Bum Phillips. Now to this day, people argue about whether or not Phillips deserved to be fired. You have some saying that the firing was completely deserved because of his refusal to hire an offensive coordinator, while the play calling was insanely predictable and the move to get Ken Stabler did not work at all. You have others saying that it was one of the most unjust, most undeserving firings in NFL history, only rivaled by when the San Diego Chargers fired Marty Schottenheimer after a 14-2 season. However, whatever your feelings on that are, it's universally agreed upon that the successor, Ed Biles, was worse in every way, shape, and form. Ed Biles is one of the worst head coaches in the history of the NFL. In his 2.5 seasons in charge, the Oilers were 8-23. He ended his coaching career on a whopping 13-game losing streak. After starting 4-2 in his first year in 1981, he went 3-21 the rest of the way, winning just one out of every 8 games. And perhaps no exhibit showcased how bad of a head coach he was, and just how unfit he was to lead a team, than what happened in 1982 with what has to be one of the worst, most mismanaged quarterback controversies of all time. Because if you want an exhibit on what not to do if you don't want to create a quarterback controversy, then don't do what Ed Biles is about to do. It amazes me that one of the supposed 28 brightest football coaching minds in the world was this dumb and lacked all common sense, but we're breaking that down today. This is the story behind, quite easily, the dumbest quarterback controversy in the history of the Houston Oilers. Before I talk about the actual incident in question, we need some context to understand the game that led to the quarterback controversy in the first place, and how the Oilers were doing beforehand. It's November 21st, 1982, and it's week 11, or I guess week 3 depending on how you want to look at it, of the NFL season. I would say we have an AFC Central rivalry game on our hands down at the Astrodome between the Houston Oilers and the Pittsburgh Steelers, but divisions have been eliminated by this point, so we'll just call it an AFC rivalry game, because who the heck knows what's going on in 1982 anyway. Aside from the obvious rivalry aspect of the game, this was a big game because it was the first game back after the strike. The last time the Oilers played a game was on September 19th, more than 2 months ago, when they took on the Seattle Seahawks and won 23-21. Just to have football back was a nice feeling after so many Sundays off, one of which was spent with Pat Summerall and John Madden broadcasting a game of college football. You can learn more about that incredibly bizarre, yet incredibly wonderful experiment by clicking the card in the upper right corner. And leading the charge for the Oilers going into this game under center was Gifford Nielsen. The good news for Nielsen was that after a successful end to the 1981 season, where he was named the starter for the final two games, and threw 3 touchdowns while completing over 67% of his passes, and posting a great passer rating of 92.7, and where he beat the Steelers thanks to a game-winning touchdown in the fourth quarter, he was named the starter for the 1982 season. The bad news was that 1981 was looking like a fluke, because through the first two games of the new year, he was not it at all. His completion percentage dipped to under 52%. He had already been sacked 6 times in 2 games. He started games off terribly, with the Oilers scoring no first quarter points, and he ended games terribly, with the Oilers scoring no offensive touchdowns in the third quarter in either game. A lot of people suspected after that poor start that his seat was hot, and it was about to get even hotter after the Oilers made a trade right before the strike with the New Orleans Saints, where they traded away Leon Gray, their starting left tackle for every game in 1981, a 4-time Pro Bowler including in 1981, and a 3-time first-team All-Pro in exchange for Archie Manning. Giving up one of the best starters on the offensive line in football for a quarterback tells you everything you need to know about how the organization felt about Gifford Nielsen under center. But hey, maybe with this game against the Steelers coming back from the strike, he could prove everyone wrong. Alas, he could not. By all accounts, and by every measure imaginable, the performance was ugly with a capital U, because everything about Nielsen's play in this game that could have gone wrong did. always a good sign when your first snap of the game results in a sack. That sack was a pretty good omen for how things were going to go. Drive number one ended after Nielsen got sacked again, resulting in a 3-and-out. 2 out of 3 ain't bad when it comes to Meatloaf, but when it comes to plays on a drive ending in a sack, that's atrocious. Drive number two ends in even worse fashion, as this drive ends after Nielsen's pass down the sideline is intercepted by Dwayne Woodruff. It's funny because before the game, when talking about what to expect in the first game back following a 2-month strike, with regards to what side of the ball has the advantage, head coach Ed Biles said, "I think it's going to be an exciting brand of football. It may be a throwback to the old American Football League days, where there were a lot of touchdowns scored." Yeah, I don't think his starting quarterback got the memo. Drive number three ends before the Oilers are able to cross midfield, as another good play in the secondary from Woodruff, this time on a pass breakup on third down, stalls Houston in its tracks. Remember how one of the problems for Nielsen was that he started games off really slowly before the strike? That trend was here to stay. Drive number four ended in a punt, with the Oilers, pinned deep in their own territory, unable to get a first down. Drive number five, and shocker, it ends in a punt. I think by this point, Oilers fans were hoping that the team would go back on strike. Drive number six, and it once again ends in a punt. You get the idea, and I'm not going to show the rest of the drives, because I don't want to make your eyes bleed any more than they already are. The Oilers were not moving the ball whatsoever with Nielsen under center, as by the time the game ended, Nielsen's stat line, in the 24-10 loss, was 17 for 39 for a completion percentage of 43.6%, 3 interceptions, and, you know it's coming, a passer rating of 37.2, which is worse than if he did nothing but spike the ball into the ground on every single play. And things got so bad that in the second half, with Nielsen sputtering badly, Biles decided to make the switch and put Archie Manning in at quarterback for the first time ever in an Oilers uniform. Just like that, the quarterback controversy was officially on between Gifford Nielsen and Archie Manning. Except, it wasn't. Because in the post-game press conference, and in the day after the game, Biles quashed the quarterback controversy by saying that it was Nielsen's job. And he went about this in literally the stupidest and most insulting way possible. Now look, there's a right way and a wrong way to handle this situation. And there's a bunch of different ways you can say that even though you benched a quarterback, that he's still your guy. This, however, is the prime example of how not to handle such a situation. After the game, Biles said on why he took Nielsen out, "We decided early in the week that we would have to substitute freely. We felt like it is asking a lot of a young quarterback like Gifford to play an entire game under these conditions." So according to Biles, Nielsen was never going to be playing the whole game. There are a few reasons why I'm not buying that excuse at all. Number one, Nielsen isn't young. Gifford Nielsen, by this point, was 28 years old and was in his fifth season in the NFL. How is that young? Imagine if Andy Reid said that he didn't want to ask too much out of Patrick Mahomes because he's young. That's not even a good comparison, because Mahomes is 2 years younger than Nielsen was at the time of this game. Number two, you had incredibly limited practice time coming back from the strike. You had players coming back from the strike, trying to get back into shape, and trying to remember the playbook. And you're going to spend that valuable but limited time preparing not one, but two quarterbacks to run the offense against the Pittsburgh Steelers defense? That seems like a dumb idea. That's like if I'm in a band and I only have 10 minutes to learn this part to the song before we go on stage, so I spend those 10 minutes splitting my time between learning that part and learning a part to a completely different song that we're not even playing that night. How does that make any sense? Number three, you're telling me that if Nielsen was playing well, that you would still make the switch? Your plan was banking on your quarterback not playing well and finishing the game? Seems bizarre. But number four, and the big one, was that when Archie Manning was asked about this, he said that he had no idea what Biles was talking about, because he didn't know that he was going into the game, and had no idea about the plan until he was told to get ready on the sidelines. Yep, that definitely seems like a man who is in on this plan. It was such a well-kept secret that you'd be playing two quarterbacks, that not even the second quarterback knew about it. So Biles created a quarterback controversy by saying that he was going to play two quarterbacks all along, even though neither quarterback knew about that plan, which meant that either Biles lied to the press or he lied to his players. But hang on, because it gets worse. because this quarterback controversy, if you can believe it, is about to get even dumber. Biles just wanted to continue digging the world's deepest hole, because afterwards, he said that Nielsen was still his quarterback, but he gave a bizarre reason why. He said, "This is not the time of the year to have the quarterback situation become competitive. At that particular position, you have to recognize what decision you made in the preseason and why you made it. I feel like when you make a decision, you should go along with it." There is a lot to unpack with this statement, so let me get this straight. The reason that Nielsen was still your starting quarterback was because you named him the starter in the preseason? This meant that no matter what happens, you keep your job and nothing's changing until 1983? I'm sorry, what? There are so many things wrong with this, but I've got 5 big ones, and I really could make it 50. First off, if there was ever a year to throw preseason out the window and pretend like it didn't happen, it was 1982, when there was a 2-month gap between games, and when players are trying to get back into game shape and relearn everything. Secondly, I get the idea of not wanting your quarterback position to become competitive, and not wanting to have your starting quarterback looking over his shoulder every week. Believe me, I totally get that. You want your quarterback to feel secure, and don't want him to be feeling the hot seat after every bad pass. But there is a fine line between that and saying that no matter what he does, because he won the job in the preseason, that's his job forever. So if he throws 4 interceptions in each of the next 3 games, you're not making a switch because he won the job in the preseason? How does that make any sense? Third, like I said, I get the idea of not wanting your quarterback position to become competitive. You know how you, as the head coach, can prevent that? Don't put the backup quarterback in! If you don't want to create a quarterback controversy, then don't put the second quarterback in the game! If I want to sing a song at karaoke, and I want people to focus solely on me and no one else, and I want to sing all the words, I'm not going to pick a duet. Seems like common sense. Fourth, of course Skipper Nielsen won the job in the preseason over Archie Manning. Wanna know why? Archie Manning wasn't on the team! Archie Manning was on the New Orleans Saints. Remember? The guy you traded for to upgrade your quarterback position? That guy? That's like me complaining that the San Francisco 49ers didn't start Trey Lance at quarterback at Super Bowl 54. Wanna know why they didn't start him? He wasn't on the team! It's not really much of a competition if it's only one person. But number 5, and perhaps the most asinine part of all of this, if this is truly a reasoning that you don't make quarterback changes in the middle of the season because they earn the job in the preseason, then why the heck did you trade for Archie Manning? Why did you trade for a 33-year-old quarterback past his prime? And it's not the fact that you traded for Manning. If you did it by giving up a draft pick, that's one thing. But you gave up a starter. You gave up your starting 4-time Pro Bowl tackle to acquire a quarterback that you had no intention of playing because he didn't earn the job in the preseason. If that was the case, why didn't you just wait until next year to do this? Why would you give up a starter and get absolutely nothing of value back for this year? Giving up a starter for a past-his-prime quarterback that you didn't even want to play in the first place is one of the dumbest front office moves I think I've ever seen. Legitimately, nothing about this move makes any sense. So just to recap where we are in this bizarre controversy while I catch my breath. We have a head coach who benched his starting quarterback for the backup, who then said after the game that that was his plan all along to switch quarterbacks during the game, even though the quarterback he was putting in and the quarterback he was benching had no idea about the plan. Then the coach doubled down on this by saying that his starting quarterback was still his starter because he won the job in the preseason against a guy that wasn't even on the team, and that you acquired it in a trade because you needed to upgrade at that position. Is your head spinning yet with how confusing this all is? This man was a head coach. This was the man that the Oilers fired Bum Phillips for. All Biles had to do during that game against the Steelers was say, "Nielsen's still our starter, but we took him out because we felt that Manning could give us a spark." Remember, this was the first game in 2 months, so to ask anyone to play the full 60 minutes after being off for so long is a lot. And we saw Nielsen's play go down in the second half, so we figured we'd make the switch to try and win this game. But this doesn't change anything about our plans going forward. Was that so hard? Instead, Biles went and did, well, whatever the heck this was. It's no surprise that the Oilers didn't win another game for the rest of the season, and finished the strike-shortened season with a 1-8 record, with the great irony being that a few days after that statement, Gifford Nielsen slipped on a piece of wet turf and sprained his ankle, meaning that Manning was the starting quarterback for the majority of the season. So what's the moral of the story here? If you're going to create a game plan that involves having another person do something, it's probably best to let that other person know that you're doing that. If you want to ensure the best results possible, it's probably not a good idea to base it solely off of a performance from months ago when times were drastically different and when the person that won the position is not performing well. And for the love of God, if you're a head coach watching this video, and you're in the middle of a quarterback controversy yourself that you need to get sorted and straightened out, think to yourself, what would Ed Biles do? And then, do literally the exact opposite. Get your official Jaguar Gear 9 merchandise by going to jg9shop.com, and be sure to like this video, ring the notification bell, and subscribe down below if you haven't already, as it helps the channel out a lot. And be sure to check out Twitch every Wednesday night at 9 p.m. Eastern for your chance to play NFL trivia and win cash prizes. Link in the description below. If you want to see videos like this condensed down to 60 seconds, then follow me on TikTok at JaguarGator9. To see college football videos, subscribe to JaguarGator8. To see highlight videos of players throughout the history of the NFL, subscribe to JG9 Highlights. Also, special thanks to all of our Patreon supporters for helping out the channel. Your support is greatly appreciated. So you can become a patron and request future video topics in the description below.